Huawei may have dominated the news with its foldable flagships in the past few weeks, but now that the foldable fever is kind of fading a little bit, it's time to launch some regular old smartphones. The P30 and P30 Pro may be traditional flagships, but that doesn't mean they're not interesting. They're actually an evolution of Huawei's partnership with Leica in that they're continuing to evolve or deliver the excellence in mobile photography that Huawei has done with the P series in the past 2 years now. In addition to unique and promising new camera features, the P30 and P30 Pro are also really powerful from my brief preview with it and come in some pretty colors as well as offer some other unique features that make them altogether very interesting smartphone for those of you who can get your hands on it. The P30 Pro is the phone we spent more time with because it is more interesting, and I'll spell out the differences between that and the regular version later. But the P30 Pro is the first Leica quad camera system in Huawei's lineup. I'm gonna break down what all of these are before we take a deeper look at each of them. In the center of this row of cameras is a 40 megapixel super spectrum camera that uses some new technology that Huawei came up with to allow for more light. It has an f1.6 aperture as well as optical image stabilization and a wide angle field of view that should make it pretty versatile for your daily shooting. Above that sits a 20 megapixel ultra wide lens that goes up to f2.2 in terms of aperture and a field of view that Huawei is only willing to tell us at this point is bigger than 120 degrees. At the bottom, you'll see this squarish looking sensor. It is the 8 megapixel, 5x optical zoom in what Huawei is calling a periscope zoom stack design. Finally, sitting next to this row of three cameras is the time of flight sensor that should help add depth effects to your pictures, as well as do something with AR maybe. So let's get into that super spectrum sensor. What Huawei did here is instead of just trying to add more cameras to the Huawei P30 Pro, like Nokia is doing with, say, the PureView, for example, it's trying to rethink how sensors work. And what it did is instead of doing a traditional RGB color layer on top of the monochrome layer in a sensor, it's swapping out greens for yellow. And so you have an RYB filter on top of the monochrome. According to Huawei, this will let in more light because yellow just allows for more light than green. But Huawei did have to tweak its image processing algorithms to better extrapolate the colors out of the yellow that it's receiving to maintain the accurate colors that you still see from RGB sensors. During our testing, I really didn't notice like a huge difference in terms of color with this RYB sensor. Huawei's tweaks to its algorithms seems to have worked. I didn't notice any difference in greens or blues or yellows. These still came out mostly true to life. The benefit of the RYB sensor here is that you can achieve much higher ISO light sensitivity. So the P20 Pro last year could hit up to ISO 102-400, but the P30 Pro can go up to ISO 409-600. The P30 itself, the regular model, can go up to ISO 204-800, which is not as much as the Pro, but still a significant jump from the predecessors. With all this improvement in light sensitivity, we really saw a remarkable difference. And when we tested the P30 Pro in a very dark room on a plate of pastries, the effect was pretty significant. The photo I shot on the P30 Pro looked like it was taken almost in daylight. It was very colorful, very bright, and with really sharp details. It is the effect you'd achieve with Google's Night Sight, but without really having to hold the phone for as long. Now, of course, you can still switch over to the night mode on the P30 Pro, which will still require you to hold your phone steady, but even in the regular mode, you'd still get plenty of clarity and light in the low light shots. Moving on to the wide angle camera, really here you're just getting a nice versatile array of angles to shoot with. I really enjoyed how we were pointing the phone at some buildings that were right next to us and then hitting the wide angle and getting like a much wider landscape view of that and still getting very good details even as we zoomed in. And zooming in is also something you can do with a wide angle camera because it takes macro shots really nicely. Huawei uses something that it calls a hybrid zoom, which is taking the information from the other lenses and using that to give you better detail. That's Basically what it's doing with this periscope zoom, in addition to the 5x optical that it's doing there, it's also doing up to 10x with that hybrid zoom that I told you about, as well as up to 50x with a digital zoom, which simply just uses math to keep zooming in and enlarging your picture without pulling in information from the other sensors. I didn't get to spend a lot of time testing out that time of flight camera, but the portrait effect you should get from it should be very pretty. And bear in mind, this is similar to what the Galaxy S10 offers on its 5G specific version. So this is a bonus you'll get with the P30 Pro without having to shell out for a souped up 5G option. Huawei hasn't made it very clear yet whether this time of flight sensor will be used for any special AR effects just yet, but we'll have to stay tuned to find out more. Now, all of the stuff that I just told you, things like zoom and switching from wide angles to close up shots, can also be done in video, which is good because Huawei is trying to give that a boost as well. Huawei said that it has some sort of video stabilization feature in the new P30 Pro, but during my preview, it didn't seem to work very well. There was some really weird shake I couldn't account for when I switched to the close-up camera. We will have to take this out for further testing to see what's up. Flip the phone over to the front, and we've got a single 32 megapixel selfie camera. This is kind of ridiculous to me. I don't know why we need that many megapixels, but hey, if you want a super sharp selfie, you got it with the P30 Pro. It's also got this AI HDR feature that Huawei says is able to really capture the shadows in your face, even if your background's a little bit blown out. During our testing, it worked. My face didn't look blown out at all, even though the sun was shining right behind me in a selfie that we took, but I didn't get the blues in the sky that I was hoping for. So maybe I'll have to test this out in a lot more different situations before I get to see if AI HDR really works well. That brings me to the display of the P30 Pro. Now, that 32MP camera is housed in this tiny little teardrop notch because the rest of the phone's front is basically a edge-to-edge screen. On the P30 Pro, it's a slightly curved on both edge screen, and on the P30, it's just a more flat experience. I actually really like the look of the P30 Pro. The screen is a 6.7-inch OLED panel with a 2340x1080, what people are calling Full HD Plus resolution. It's the same resolution on the smaller 6.1-inch P30, so I wish they had gone for a sharper panel on the P30 Pro, but that would come with some trade-offs that we'll probably have to get to later. Overall, this is a pretty screen. It's got vibrant colors. It was easy enough to read under sunlight, although I did wish it got just a little bit brighter. Embedded under the panel is an optical fingerprint sensor that you'll use to log into your phone if you want to. Huawei's gone for an optical solution here as opposed to the ultrasonic scanners that are available via Qualcomm. So that may not be as secure or as fast perhaps, but it still works. Maybe think of it as more of a convenient option rather than a very secure way to protect your data. What I do like is that Huawei shows up an on-screen indicator of where you should lay your finger when you need to log in, and this worked quickly during our preview. You know what else worked quickly? The P30 Pro. It is kind of aggressively fast sometimes. Now we've got a Kirin 980 under the hood here, which is one of those AI processors with a dual-core neural processing unit. That won't really mean much to you unless you're doing a lot of machine learning tasks on your phone, but what you will notice, and what I did notice, was that launching apps or browsing through app lists or trying to pull up website was ridiculously fast. While the Kirin 980 is a very powerful chipset that probably provided a lot of the muscle we noticed here, I think some of this speed can be attributed to EMUI 9.1. This is Huawei's updated software interface based on Android 9 Pie, and it ships with the P30 and P30 Pro. Huawei's made some tweaks in its software that's improved performance a lot. In fact, according to the company, the tap-to-response rate is now 69% faster than before, and starting apps is 52% faster than before. It's a combination of the beefy processor as well as tweaks in the software that I think together make the P30 Pro just feel zippy so far. Powering everything that we've just talked about is a 4200 milliamp hour battery inside the P30 Pro. On the P30, this is 3650 milliamp hours, both of which should last over a day, up to 2 days if you're not using your phone a lot, according to Huawei. And you can charge it up really quickly thanks to Huawei's new supercharge standard on the P30 Pro, which should get you from 0 to 70% in about 30 minutes. You'll also find a feature that's on the Galaxy S10 and S10 Plus here, which is reverse wireless charging. You can use your Huawei P30 Pro to wirelessly charge other devices that are compatible with the standard as well. And finally, to wrap all of this up, Huawei's given us again a beautiful array of color options to choose from. These are all so beautiful, and again, it's something that Huawei has pioneered in the smartphone industry. A lot of people are following suit, and it's nice to see that Huawei has continued to improve this. Now, based on my early time with the P30 Pro and some little time with the P30, these two do seem like very compelling flagships. I really can't wait to take them out on a photo walk and test them out. The sad news is, we still don't know whether it'll be available in the US. It's highly likely that they won't be available stateside, but for the rest of the world, you might be compelled to check this out. We'll get our hands on one soon, so stay tuned to Engadget for the full review.